Come your way. Heidi and Gary doing the party.
Oh, we can see who's the laugh a minute of the audio. How do you? Where do you record the voice? How does that work?
In the booth.
In the booth, yeah. The laugh a minute man of the booth. That's what I was trying to say.
I'm Heidi Gardner.
I'm Gary Anthony Williams.
So, when you're in the booth, what do you have to work from? Do you have the figure reference?
When I'm in the booth, I have ointments. I have a lot of ointments, a lot of body oils.
I don't know about that. That
you need to hear this.
Okay, tell me
this
about that.
This is what you need to hear.
What
first of all, now I know fabric makes a lot of noise. You can probably hear it. On your microphone. I go in there shirtless every time. Shirtless and skin tight pants. I played a couple of different characters on the show now. One we didn't talk about yet because I don't know if they're ready to talk about that character.
You can tell
yet.
Us.
But I can tell you. And I have nothing. There are no character models for Santa. I invented that character, so there was no model for him. And the other character I was playing, no, there was no model
for him.
What's
the other character
called?
Yet.
I don't know if I can say yet. I honestly don't. I'm truly not, Mark. If I find out I can during this interview, I will give you all the information
you
need.
Because he likes to talk.
I love to talk.
Yeah.
And then for you, your booth experience?
My booth experience. You just get the script, you get a little pencil to make some notes. And bottled water, and the judging eyes of the director. But it's fun. It's weird, you know. Sometimes you're like, I'm really feeling it. I know exactly how to say the line. And then every so often, it's like you stop being a human being. And some sentences, I've said it to Zed the last time I recorded. I was like, I know I suck at this line. I just know it. I can't get it right. So can you please just tell me exactly how you want it said?
That will happen. Like that will. Some directors are afraid to. Sometimes you need a line reading because you can't make it work. And you know that they wrote it or they've been sitting with it longer than you.
Yeah.
And sometimes you have to go, hey, can you just give me a line reading on that?
But they're so timid.
Some of them are timid because we've both had directors who just will give you line readings all the time and nobody wants that. You want to be creative. But sometimes you actually need it. Like, I have no idea where you're going.
And no topless.
And no topless?
Yeah.
Yeah, I don't do skins.
She wets her clothes down so it doesn't make her rustle.
Yeah,
so.
Yeah. Hair and clothes.
Yeah, she wets her.
I like going wet hair.
Wet hair.
Yeah.
Zeb touched on it in the panel about like the evolution of Cooch as a character from like Crass to someone with like a little more heart and like wonder about the world. Could you talk a little bit about like what that's been like for you to kind of get to know this character more?
I mean, I love it so much more because, you know, there's only so many Crass, sex, I'm in heat jokes that you can make. But it's fun. It's like everything's new to her because she's a cat and now a person too. So she's just like figuring out life. And even though like she might swear a lot, she is like loyal, wants to be Bud. So everybody that, you know, like comes into her world, it's like, okay, you could be a new friend, you know, you could be a new ally, which is cool. So I love that. I love that it switched a little from the first season.
How do you keep like you said before, like there's only so many jokes that you can do. How do you keep it fresh when you keep having to do those kinds of things? How does it?
I think that, you know, I wrote a little on the second season and just like talking to Zed because you just innately run out of storylines for the character because they're just in a box and they're known as this thing, and it's like, what can we do to like change her up and give her more to do, you know, and like change people's minds a little bit about her.
So you see that there will be character growth
because
you've added your own take to the character?
Yeah, I think so. Yeah, and I think sometimes like I even notice with the writers in the room for Cooch or other new characters that come into the season, sometimes you're just like riffing on this character and it's like, oh, okay, and he'll do this and he'll do this, and it's like, why not make that character a woman too? Like, immediately they jump to just like, oh, a guy does this, or, you know, and it's like, oh, but if a female can do that as well, it's just in our brains where they're like, oh, a guy, so.
And how about for you? Yeah. Oh, okay. Yeah. Yeah, no, for yourself, I mean, what do you do to keep it fresh? You know, I'm Santa Claus, of course.
Yeah, well, but just in the voice overall.
Yeah, and
in
not, you know,
I mean, a lot of it, you just got to depend on the writer or director. You got to depend on them to know that they have a show that the legs of that show can be as long as one episode, or you pull a Simpsons and then you're on since 1987 or whatever it is. So you got to know those characters. Homer isn't always just going to go dope and bark, you're stupid. He's got to be going somewhere else. I think so much of it depends on that. When they let you improvise, or like she's doing now, writing in it, you can always poke in a little bit of character, a little bit of your character flaws or their hopes and desires or whatever, just some odd thing. You can always poke some stuff in there that somebody can run with, especially her now in the writing seat. But honestly, most of it for me in this show, especially like as a performer, that's it. Like when I did the Boondocks, I got to improvise all the time, and so that was no problem. Like, oh, that's funny, let's write an episode about that. And this, you are at the beck and call of those guys, who fortunately, the episodes I've done, every time I read a script, I laugh out loud. Like, it's just some funny shit they're writing. And it makes you be on your A game when you get in there.
Do you have a difficult time doing I think it's called Walla, with those grunts, like, those kind of, as I know, I've heard a lot of other voice actors who say that that's the most difficult part, because you're not getting physically punched or hit or...
I don't know if it's that, you know what, there's a weird thing. What's difficult for me is the inhale. I don't know why, but what's more difficult is, especially in action stuff, it will blow your voice out. And that usually they'll save it till the very end, because grunts and punches and dying, it'll blow your voice. And even now, if you audition, it usually says strenuous voice work to let you know, even if you want to do it.
Yeah. And you don't ever really know. I don't know if I'm nailing a grunt, because I've never done it in life. So.
Can I tell you? Nail a grunt.
I like that expression, nailing a grunt.
Yeah.
Let's get her in here. This girl can nail a grunt. Let's get her in here.
So I'll do like three takes, and then gives that like a really insecure look. Like, is that what you wanted? Or he'll make me do another three grunts.
I'm sorry, I don't know if you... Are there things you look for in terms of, like, the development of the characters that you can impose, or is there, like, a Bible that you reference to kind of fit into the universe, or you just are going... I know either one of you,
okay. And
how that works for you, because you're, you know, kind of like I have a special little province, and then your overall continuity.
For me, mine's very simple. For me, I'm straight off the streets. Like, I get the phone call, and they send me a script if it's ready. If not, I'll see it for the first time when I'm in the booth. So I quickly just read that character, and I get an image of who that character is, especially if there are no drawings of it. Like, the last one I did, there wasn't a drawing of it yet. But when I got in the booth, they told me who he was, how weighted he was. And then we play around with three or four, five, six voices, and they go, that one, do that one, and make him a little gravelly like the first one, and then lock it in and go from there.
How lucky do you feel?
I just wanted you to answer the...
Oh, sorry. Well, Zeb is like the ultimate Bible, because he knows the character so well. So immediately, like writing-wise... You know, definitely people would pitch jokes that felt very Black Saturn, or that you would think, you know, but Zeb's the one to be like, it's not quite who he is. So he's kind of the ultimate Bible for us.
How lucky do you two feel being on the show? Because, you know, there's all these stuff in the news about roles for women and inclusion. So how lucky do you two feel?
Well, it's great. And the cool thing about Zeb is, like, they have come to... I'm in an improv comedy group called the Black Version, All Black Improv Comedians. And they have come... They've seen so many of those shows. And so they're out there looking for funny people that they might not know yet. who are of color or, you know, different sexes. I don't know how many different sexes there are. So they're out there looking for that thing that other people aren't looking for or doing and say and claim that they are.
Oh, we need more diversity.
They're just doing it. They're just hiring people who are funny and of color or female or male or whatever it is. So I feel very lucky. I definitely feel lucky, and I'm glad they're doing what they're doing.
You're not only
the
kind of role, but you're writing
it. Yeah, well, I played the cat on the show. So, and when I, just sitting down at this table and realizing I got to do this with Gary is the dream, because 6 years ago, Zeb and I were seeing the improv show that he was talking about. And just in the car ride home, I would say to Zeb, like, I hope that I get to work with Gary Anthony Williams one day on stage, and then Zeb, now there's a show. So I feel so lucky.
And I got home that night, and my wife was like, what one thing do you want? And I was like, ever in the world? Yeah, to work with Heidi someday.
That girl in the crowd that lasts a while.
So working in the booth is very singular. How often do you guys get to interact, like, actors-wise?
Today.
Yeah.
Just today.
On this show, I've never been in the booth with anyone else.
Yeah. Only one time for me, and I was telling them it was because the actor playing Brad and I, it was like a dramatic moment between the two of us, and we'd recorded it separately, and I guess both didn't do a good job. So Zeb was like, you need to do it together, because there's no chemistry in it. But that was great to get to do it with them.
On other shows, it differs depending on the show and depending on actor's schedule, but this one, yeah.
Have you ever done a show where... If you do a table read, or if you're in the booth or studio together, where you didn't particularly like the person you were acting across from, but you had to like get that chemistry there anyway?
More on camera than in voiceover for me. I've been on camera with some people that are like, oh man, that dude, I can't wait to get home and tell my wife about this guy. I've been on camera more with that person, and I will name names.
Well, okay.
Keegan Michael Key. I said it. But not. I've been pretty lucky in voiceover. I don't know
how to
look
for you. I can't think of anyone I haven't liked so much.
So is there a big party plan with all these characters, all the actors that I see on the list, finally you're going to get to meet, and besides Keegan and the other people?
Yeah, your house for a big barbecue.
Yeah, it's a big barbecue tonight. We're going to watch the debates and barbecue.
Yeah.
Oh, Lord, please tell me there's alcohol.
It has to be. We're watching the debate. Sorry,
can I get a quick shot at the
Just do it!
Pretending like you're having fun? You know that's a hard concept to believe, right? Now you finally met, right?
This way of things.